Hey, welcome. I'm glad you all made it here. Everybody's here, I think. Raise your hand if you're part of the Nashville Now staff or show, or if you've actually seen television. All right. I'm what's left of Gary Beatty, and thank you for being here today. I borrowed that line from Hoyt Axton. I remembered him for years. He always came out and said, I'm what's left of Hoyt Axton, and just kind of stuck with me. We're going to do a little run-through today of what used to be, I thought, one of the best shows on television, cable television ever. It got me through two airplanes and a son at NYU and several other things that I'm happy to be going today. And a lot of your favorite folks are here from the show. You're going to love this. And thanks to the Nashville Public Library for putting this together. That's part of their... I don't know all the deal about it. I know that they're doing a series or plan to do a series as much as they can probably on that Nashville Sound, which means a lot of different things to all of us. They've already done a program with Ray Stevens, who is on our show today. And the Public Library Foundation has got its work cut out for it because there's a lot of great history, a lot of great legacy that'll be part of the Nashville Sound forever and ever. So I think you're going to love today's show. So. I think I'm the only one actually performing today, if you call announcing performing. I'm going to try to remember to do the intro just as we did live every night, five nights a week from the old studio, which sadly is no longer there. I have to grab my heart and salute every time I pass run by the Opry House on Briley Parkway, because the old studio and the office building, none of it's there. It's just a parking lot now, which is very sad, but... What can I say? Whenever you guys are ready, we'll do it, all right? Yeah. Oh, one other thing. Each night I used to come out and talk to the audience before the show for 2 or 3 minutes, just like now. And one of the things was I always remember, turn off your flash. But it occurred to me today as I was getting ready to come out here, when we started the show, there was no such thing as a cell phone. So turn off your cell phones, all right? The Nashville Public Library presents That Nashville Sound. Today's show is being brought to you by the Nashville Public Library Foundation. Live from Music City, USA, it's Ralph Emery's Nashville Now. Our guests today are Tom T. Hall, Don Hunley, Ray Stevens, Lori Morgan, Barbara Mandrell, Steve Hall with Shotgun Red, Reba McIntyre, and Jerry Whitehurst and the Nashville Now Band. And now, live from the Nashville Public Library, here's the host of Nashville Now, Ralph Emery.
Thank you. Bless you all. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Gary. Sounded very, very familiar. You haven't missed a beat. I want to explain why two people are not here that you announced, and not your fault. But we had scheduled Reba. Reba's brother, Paik, whom many of you may know, had a stroke, and he's in the hospital in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And plus, he is... preparing a 2-month stay in Las Vegas, and she just didn't have time to come over here, and she sent all of you her love. I found out this morning that Tom T. Hall was out in the garden Thursday, and the little things that are in the air at this time of the year overwhelmed him, and his doctor has insisted he stay home. The rest of the gang are here, and it's so nice to see all of you. And I want to first of all thank the Nashville Public Library and their celebration of Nashville Now. Let's thank the Nashville Library for what they're doing. I was fortunate enough to host Nashville Now for 10 years and about 6 months. It's been a big part of my life, and for better or worse, it's all on videotape. I've had many experiences, mostly fun, some a little, shall we say, a little uncomfortable. We'll revisit many of those experiences today, and we'll be amazed mostly by how we've all changed, especially our hairstyles and hair color. Nashville Now was first and foremost entertaining, with great performers from every part of show business, and some of those great performers and friends are here today. And it was awful. The program was also responsible for launching the careers of many talented people. And it was also very funny because we had a comedic bent on certain nights. We had showcased the talents of many comedians, some you've heard of, and mostly some will surprise you from these early performances. Now, I must tell you that the videos that you're going to witness are 20 to 30 years old. And what we're going to show you first is something that surprised even me. Ricky Skaggs told me that this very influential gentleman was a fan of our show. Let's roll the tape from New York.
And now, the Country Music Association's Entertainer of the Year, David Letterman!
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Ralph Emery, and welcome to Nashville.
Now, this really feels familiar. I want to tell you a few things about Nashville Now. The show began on the night of March 7th, 1983. It ended on Friday night, October the 15th, 1993. In an effort to promote our network, our first show, 5 hours long, lasted from 8 p.m. until 1 a.m. In an effort to promote the show nationwide, we had 5 satellite remote pickups stretching from coast to coast. First, there was T.G. Shepherd, who is with us today, and he was with Roseanne Cash at the Savoy Hotel in New York. Following that, we had Bill Monroe and Demi Lou Harris from Austin, Texas, then up to Chicago and Tammy Wynette and Don Williams, then Lynn Anderson and George Goober Lindsay, we picked them up in Denver, and finally on the West Coast, Tanya Tucker and Hoyt Axton holding forth at the Palomino Club in Los Angeles. Back in Nashville, we had 2 home bases. The evening's entertainment consisted of 1 hour, a musical extravaganza from the Opry House, and it was hosted by a tuxedoed Roy Acuff. And Roy was joined by a sequined Patty Page, along with Chet Atkins, Larry Gatlin, and his brothers, Ray Stevens. They were all over at the Opry House. Then, since our home base, the one we were to ultimately use, wasn't ready, we were in the stage door lounge of the Opryland Hotel. And there on that first night, I interviewed the host of the upcoming shows to be on TNN. For instance, Bill Anderson was scheduled to do Fandango, his game show. As our home in the Gaslight Theater, I think we finally got there in June of that year. Anyway, where do we go from here? Before I show you the following Nashville Now tapes, I want to remind you they are between 20 and 30 years old, but a tribute to the outstanding work done by the Nashville Network crew. And as I said earlier, Nashville Now was influential. We had a large audience of some 6 to 7, 8 million people who wanted to, I must tell you that a number of, this was the summer of 1983, and we had a political campaign coming up, and we had a lot of politicians that came by that wanted to be on. And especially one who was a little nervous because he didn't know how I felt about him. And he had a good friend in the sausage business, Jimmy Dean. So President Bush, who was our sitting president at that time, aboard Air Force One, called Jimmy to see if I could be persuaded to be nice to him. Listen.
Hello.
Yes, Mr. Dean, this is Air Force One. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, I can.
Roger, stand by for the president, please. Hey, Jimmy, where are you?
I'm at home in Virginia.
I got a big favor I want of you.
What do you want, George?
I want you to call Ralph Emery, whose show I'm going to be on. You remember your old pal?
Oh, God, yeah. As a matter of fact, I'm going down there today.
I just thought it'd be nice if you said, now be nice to my friend George Bush.
All right, well, you know, he's an intense and loyal fan.
Well, that's great, Jim, but I just thought, you know, because you were so damn nice setting it up. You remember we went over there that time?
I sure do.
Nice little reminiscence to tell him that. We're going to be on there about 7 o'clock. I don't know whether it's live or taped or what it is, but he's such a good guy.
7 o'clock, that time, it'll have to be taped, George.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Well, that's fine, but any event and any thoughts of what to say about it, but it's, you know, he's such a good guy that
Is it? I will see to it.
Thanks for taking the call, and call, what's his name, Ralph, and just give him a big abrazo.
Okay. Good luck. God bless.
If you do that, I'll buy one of those silly looking things with a pork in the middle of it and the bread on the outside that you're advertising them.
All right, George. I love you. Bye-bye.
Be good.
Jimmy gave me that tape. I've never felt so important in my life. Now, prior to that happening, about a month prior to that happening, and I've got to tell you that President Bush, nice guy, really a nice guy. I'm sorry he didn't win the election, but he did fine on the show. I think we're going to show you an impression that he does of Jimmy Dean selling sausage. I think that will be in a tape coming up. Is that scheduled for now?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's roll it.
You didn't say you had one damn Jimmy Dean record in your collection. I heard that.
Wait a minute.
No, that's right. I'm hurt.
I'm not that old, but I did say I'd eat one of those. I'm only 68, but I said this, that I'd eat one of those funny little things on a sausage stick that he's advertising if he treated me nicely here. Now. A little stick. This is fine for you. This is just fine. Now, you ought to try it. Now, eat it. It's very good.
All right. That was President Bush. Now, he may have been nervous. I don't know whether he saw the appearance of Bill Clinton and Mrs. Clinton and Vice President Gore and Mrs. Gore had been on about a month prior to President Bush. And I had them, since they were from Arkansas, I asked them if they could do that Arkansas hog call that they do at the football games. Well, when a politician is running as seriously as they were running, they'll do anything you ask them. And as was the case, if you'll watch, as they do the Arkansas fighting hog call.
Well, I know you're a great collector, and Alan Tipper and Hillary and I wanted to give you this model of our bus that we've been taking across America, reaching out to ordinary people, most of whom, like us, are country music fans.
Well, I was invited to come to the Clinton inauguration, and I was invited to MC one of the inaugural balls. And when I ran into then the now elected President Clinton, he said, "Have you still got your bus?" And I said, "Yes, I do, and I still have it to this day." And that was one of the real unique moments here at Nashville Now. There were other unique moments, but they didn't involve politicians. I remember one night, let me back this story up a little bit and tell you that if you were a guest of ours at Nashville Now, we gave you a little blue card to fill out. And you told us a little bit about yourself, your name, your address, where you were from, who you had brought to the show, and could you tell us something maybe about your friend who is with you. Anyway, accidentally we ran across a lady who was a pen pal and had been a pen pal for 41 years with a lady she had never met. So we jumped on that when we found out about it, and we managed through their husbands to make sure that they came to the show the same night. And here we go.
I believe we have somebody in the audience that wants to say hi to a pen pal. Where is that lady? Are you the lady? Would you come up here, please? I've never had a pen pal. Let's step right down here. I've never had anybody that would write to me. How long have you been pen paling with this pen pal?
About 41 years.
Really?
Yeah.
How did you find this person's name?
Well, in a teenage magazine when I was 13 years old.
You just wanted somebody?
I just told my age, didn't I?
Well, I'm not going to bear down on that. What do you write to each other about?
Well, we've become very close through the years, and she is vacationing here in Nashville right now.
Is she? How do you know that?
She wrote me 2 or 3 weeks ago, but I had no idea that I would be here.
What do pen pals talk about for 41 years?
Well, we've been through a lot. We feel very close, even though we've never met each other.
You've never met this person?
No, never.
What is this person's name?
Her name is Jenny Crandall, and she's from Abington, Massachusetts.
Really? Would you like to meet her?
I sure wouldn't.
Jenny, where are you? She's here tonight. Did you know that? Jenny, would you come down here? These ladies have been corresponding for 41 years, have never met each other. Girls, would you come over here so we could share some of this? I'd like for one of you to get on one side, and see, if I don't get between you, I'll never get a word in.
I must tell you, we had an interesting neighbor who lived behind the Nashville Now studio. Mr. Roy Acuff, he lived with us on that campus, and he moved there upon hearing of the death of String Bean, killed by people who had heard him on the Grand Ole Opry and laid in wait for him at his house and murdered him for his money. Mr. Acuff was fearful that would happen to him, so he talked to Bud Wendell, the boss out at the compound, and Bud said, we'll build you a house out here and you can come and live with us. And I bring that up because at the end of the evening where we had these ladies, I heard at the back door somebody yelling, and it was Mr. Acuff. He said, I want to meet them women. And he was fascinated by the show and came over quite often to critique what we were doing. He was a wonderful, supportive gentleman. When we thought about what we would do with the Nashville Library and who should be on the show, I immediately thought of my friend from Knoxville. He is a gentleman who was on our first show. He was on our last show. He sang the first song on the show and the last song on the show. Please welcome Con Hunley.
Well, the man you're about to see was on our very first telecast of Nashville Now, that one that was 5 hours long that first night, and he's back here tonight here in Texas. Came down from Knoxville. I call him the Smoky Mountain Blue-Eyed Darling. Would you welcome Con Hunley?
Got you now, that's all that matters to me.
We're going to close with what isn't a very appropriate song called Quitting Time, and here again is Con Hunley.
It's quitting time, it's quitting time. Now it's just a symbol, it's a symbol.
Well, Con, I don't think I've ever heard that song, Quitting Time, anywhere else, except that we were, and I must explain, we were all down in Texas, San Antonio, Texas, at a theme park there that I think the Gaylord Corporation had an interest in, and so that Crook and Chase, who followed our Nashville Now show, could put their set in and rehearse, they sent us to Texas to do our final show. And you got up and did Quitting Time, and we signed off.
Well, that's right, we did. And I take a lot of pride in the fact that, first and foremost, it's great to be here and great to be included. And I absolutely love this band right here. He's been a great friend of mine for a number of years. And I truly appreciate everything you did to further my career. It's been really great.
Well, I want to point out that those weren't the only times you were ever on.
Oh no. No, I was on Nashville Now several times. In fact, I did shows with Chet Atkins, and you mentioned Roy Acuff. There are a number of other people who were on. In fact, I even got to bring my entire family down. My brothers came down and sang with me on a couple of songs. So it was really big for me and my family. But to be able to do the first song on the first show and then close it out in the San Antonio, it was just ironic that the song that I had out at that time was Quitting Time. And so it worked out, really well.
And we have skirted around the song you had out in 83. It was a hit.
Yeah, it was Old Girl.
Yeah.
It was a song that was initially done by the Shy Lights, and Steve Dorff, who produced the Old Girl album, convinced me to do the song, and I really didn't think that it would probably do that well with country radio, but it got a lot of airplay, and it was going great guns at the time that the show debuted, and in fact, the Oak Ridge Boys were kind enough to come in and sing background on Old Girl, so that was pretty neat.
Did you get any reaction to being on Nashville Now?
Oh, Lord. all the time, you know. The gigs were unbelievable. I noticed that as I performed more and more in Nashville Now, everywhere I went on the road, the crowd just got bigger and bigger. Recognition of my songs, you know. People over time quit confusing me with Earl Thomas Conley and John Conley.
I had forgotten that aspect of it.
Well, you put us all together.
Earl Thomas Conley, Con Hunley, and who are we leaving out?
John Conley.
John Conley, Earl Thomas Conley.
Yeah.
I can't say that.
Yeah. John Conley, Con Hunley, and Earl Thomas Conley.
And Moms Mabley.
Yeah, Moms Mabley, yeah. She was a frequent guest on Johnny Carson, but that's another story. Initially, you know, John Conley, we were both up for newcomer of the year, and he won with rose-colored glasses, and at that time I had out Since I Fell for You, and so a lot of people got us confused. In fact, they confused us so much that I eventually worked up rose-colored glasses, and I would sing it, and people would not know the difference. So. Okay. But it was neat. And mentioning Since I Fell for You, if I could mention this, one of the greatest moments for me on Nashville Now was you had Charlie Rich on a show. In fact, I think it might have been the last TV show he did before he passed. And he and I did a duet of Since I Fell for You.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
I don't remember that.
Oh, yeah. It was fantastic.
And, well, it must have been. Two great voices.
Well, it was great. He played piano. But we swapped verses and choruses, and in fact, that's the song that I did at your Country Music Hall of Fame induction.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
Yes, sir.
All right. I want you to stay with us out here on the set.
Okay.
I may move you down here in a minute, but I'm checking here to see what I do next. Oh, yes. I'm getting a lot of help on the teleprompter. Now, this says move okay. Con Hunley to applause. Okay, we did that. Nashville Now was full of fun and funny people, and you might be surprised to remember who all appeared.
I reckon everybody knows that Grandpa is kind of hard of hearing.
Mm-hmm.
He's a very interesting person, Grandpa.
Hey.
He went to the doctor the other day to have his ears examined, and the doctor told him, said, Grandpa, you've got a suppository in your ear. And he went to the telephone and called his wife, Ramona, and he said, Ramona, stop looking for that hearing aid. I think I know where it's at.
You used to be a sheriff, didn't you?
I used to be a sheriff till I got a divorce, and this is all she left me.
You mean that little ball there is all you've got left?
One ball, pal, one ball.
I was driving in a cab, coming over here, and I was thirsty, and I've been eating some anchovy, and we stopped in a place, and the fella said, I won't give you a drink. I think you had too much already. I said, oh, I don't think so. He said, well, I think so. And I said, I can prove I'm not drunk by that one-eyed cat coming in the door. He looked over and said, now I know you're drunk. That cat's going out the door.
The cutest gal in town is gonna wed him.
Why,
that's not true. He hasn't even asked me.
I have been in this business for 36 years, and Ralph Emery is the homeliest woman I have ever seen in my life. I wouldn't follow that with nothing. I'm going to toss it on to Mike Snyder, and he has a friend with him.
That's true. The other thing about women's bathrooms, I think that is confusing to a lot of men, is women use a lot of cotton balls. And we men wonder about it because we don't use any cotton balls. I've never had one, never bought one, never needed one. I mean, I've never even been in a situation where I thought to myself, I could use a cotton ball right now. But women, right? Women need thousands of them every single day, right, fellas? I mean, they buy these bags like peat moss bags. With steel straps around it, some guy drops it off on the front lawn with a forklift. 2 days later, they're all out. They gotta get more. I had 4 cotton balls once in my life. Took me a year to use them up. My girlfriend left a little bag over there. I didn't know what to do with these things to get rid of them. I throw one on the kitchen floor like a little tumbleweed. I thought maybe the cockroaches would figure this is a dead town and move on.
Warning shots. Those are great.
Warning shots?
In Russia, they don't shoot up in the air. They shoot towards you. That's warning for the next guy.
Now, it probably wouldn't be right if I just stood here while you sung it. I should go back over there probably before you sing this song.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you can appreciate it.
Walk this way.
If I could walk that way.
Yeah. The guy went in the drugstore and he says, give me some talcum powder. And the guy said, well, walk this way. And the guy said, well, if I could walk that way, I wouldn't need the talcum powder. Right?
Soft against your skin. Like the shadows on the wall.
Hold it! Hold it! Hold it! That won't get it, son. That's too pokey for me.
Won't get it.
No, no.
What are you
doing? No, you gotta put a little fire in it.
Take the ribbon from your hands. Shake it loose and let it fall.
Son, that's more like it. I say, that's more like it. Put some fire in my bowels.
Thank you.
Now,
I happen to think Ray Stevens is a very good singer. It is often overlooked because he does such crazy songs. And most of you know what they are. Guitar Zan, The Streak, and Ahab the Arab, and so forth. But he is a very good singer, and barbecue was not one of the great examples I've ever heard.
I like barbecue.
But would you do me a favor? Would you sing a serious song here, a very pretty song to show them how well you really can sing?
Oh, okay.
Would you do that for
now,
me?
Right
yeah,
now.
Right now. Okay.
Georgia. Georgia. The whole day through. Just an old sweet song. Keeps Georgia on my mind. Song of you,
something sweet and clear, like moonlight through the pines.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's bring him out. He's here. Ray Stevens. Come out, Ray. Raymond, I want to, first of all, thank you for helping this project to succeed today. We met at Ray's office on any number of occasions to plan what we were going to do. And I appreciate your help.
Well, I didn't do much. Buddy Cal's the guy that...
Well, you're getting ahead of me here. Is Buddy in the room?
He's over there, backstage.
Can you come out here? Buddy is the hardest working son of a gun I've ever met, and he's Ray's assistant in life. And here he comes, ladies and gentlemen. Buddy, I want to thank you. Certainly, without your help, we couldn't have made it.
Well, you're very gracious.
Thank you very much.
That's true. That's true.
While I'm into that, from my house, my wife has been on the phone, on the computer, directing traffic, telling people where to go, how to get there, and is she in the room? I thought she was in the room. She's in the green room. Well, perhaps you'll meet her later. Anyway, Mr. Stevens, we were here, I'm not sure, what, last June, July, August? When did your book come out?
It was, I don't know, came out just a while back, you know.
Well, it's still for sale.
Oh, it's relatively new.
Well, we came here and did a show for the Nashville Library to promote the book. And when it was all over, I said, thank you very much. I had a good time. And folks here said, well, we want you to come back. And I said, why? And they said, we want to salute Nashville Now. So here again, you figured in the planning of this show. Well, you started this.
I was honored to be a small part. Thank you.
You want to make an announcement about what you're doing here in Nashville and how you're going to change some of the entertainment climate?
Well, I don't know if it'll make any changes, but are you talking about the cabaret?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I just bought some property, real close to town, but far enough out that people can park without having to pay anything. I think the cheapest parking down in this area is like $10, and that's for 10 minutes, you know. But we're going to have plenty of parking, and it's going to be a cabaret, spelled C-A-B-A-R-A-Y. And it's going to be a performance venue, naturally, and we're going to book artists in there that people want to see, like Con Hunley, hopefully, if he'll come and work with us. And I'm going to, of course, work there and perform there. And we're going to have a lot of music and a lot of fun, hopefully, at that location. It's a vacant lot right now, so it'll be at least a year before we're in business. But
so the ETA would be sometime in 2016?
2016, summer of 2016, hopefully.
You already have a plan?
Oh, yeah.
An architect?
I'm working with an architect right now. I drew up a little sketch of what I sort of wanted, and I gave it to him, and he's putting in all the stuff that you have to have, such as, you know, handicap access and fire code things and things like that. So
you're going back on the road, aren't you?
Yeah, I just made a new album of comedy songs, and I figured it would be only fair to the record company to go out and promote it, you know. So I've been off the road 2 years. And I just signed with an agent, and we're starting to book shows out across the country, so.
When do you start?
The first show will be June the 12th, and we're working in North Carolina, and then we're the 13th, we're working at a casino in Gulfport, Mississippi, Island View Casino, and there are a lot of casinos now in the country, and I've worked a lot of them in the past, so I'm looking forward to making that the casino location part of my touring schedule.
Well, there's one other thing I want to promote. You have recently put together a pilot for a television sequence.
Yeah, you know, we were talking and Buddy said, you know what we need, what Nashville should have now is a show about Nashville, a music talk show. Since Nashville Now is no longer here. And so we put together a show and it's, hold up the book again there, Ralph, because
we hold up what?
The book. We may call the show Ray Stevens Nashville. And it's, we built a set and shot the pilot and we're gonna try to sell it in the coming weeks. But like I say, it's a music talk show and we've got segments of the show such as songwriter segment, Nashville Cat segment. Now, Nashville Cat is a studio musician, and there's just a select group of folks that have played enough sessions over the years to become a Nashville Cat. It's really an honor to be a Nashville Cat, and they're the greatest musicians in the world. And our first Nashville Cat was Charlie McCoy on the show. He's played more harmonica than anybody living. But he was the first Nashville Cat. We have other segments. We have the old guy segment. Got a lot of fodder for that one. Bobby Bear was kind enough to come and do that, and he's still too young, but he said he'd do it. So. But it was a lot of fun, and we have a live band, and you know, it turned out really well, I think. We're still in post-production right now.
On today's show, people have toyed with their names, and they are not as advertised. Harold Ray Ragsdale, does he still exist?
Yeah, sure, with the IRS. Do you know who else is named Harold Ray?
No.
Harold Ray Bradley.
Oh,
Harold,
I didn't know.
Harold Bradley. Every time I see him, I say, hi, Harold Ray, and he says, hi, Harold Ray.
So, I didn't know that.
He's a great guitar player. Most of you folks probably know that.
I think he claims to have played on more sessions than anyone.
Any other guitar player in the world, yeah.
That's a pretty heavy claim.
Needless to say, he is a Nashville Cat.
So how do you qualify to become a Nashville Cat?
They select you. I mean, there's a committee somewhere with the Hall of Fame folks here, Country Music Hall of Fame, and they started this category, the Nashville Cats, and they select you, and there's an induction ceremony, and it's quite an honor.
When you were here last year, I asked you about your birthday, which is January the 24th, right?
Yes.
When was Harold Ray Ragsdale named Ray Stevens?
I think it was in 57. I was living in Atlanta. I came up to make a record, and it was with Capitol. I was 17. And Ken Nelson was the producer, and he didn't like my name. And so he says, I don't like Ragsdale. I said, well, you're gonna make my mama mad if you change my name. And he said, well, what was your mother's maiden name? I said, Stevens. He said, that's a good name, Ray Stevens. I said, yeah, but you're gonna make my dad mad. He said, well, we can't make everybody happy. Do you wanna make a record or not? And I said, yes, sir. You can call me anything you want to. And so that's how my name got changed.
Now, I also asked you a question. I'm not sure you ever answered it. And that was, do you have two birthdays? One for Harold Ray Ragsdale and one for Ray Stevens.
No, not yet, but you've just given me a great idea. I'll get two cakes a year. That'll be great, yeah.
Ray, I appreciate you. Ray belongs to the Breakfast Club, which I also am proud to belong to, and there are about, what, eight of us?
Well, it's kind of dwindled down to eight. You know, a lot of us have passed on, but we used to fill up a table with spilling out into the surrounding tables at the place we eat breakfast every Saturday morning. But now we just take up one big round table, and we've lost a lot of the members. Goober was one, and Do Right Sullivan was one, and so many good friends that are not with us anymore. But we keep adding new guys when the chance arises.
I think one of our new guys is in the audience.
Bergen?
Yes.
Bergasm, are you in the audience?
Yes, I am.
This
Where
is,
are you, Bergen?
Bergen White. Stand up, Bergen. There he is. And Bergen is a great musician, great arranger. He arranges sessions for everybody, Garth Brooks and the whole nine yards. And sitting next to him, I just noticed another relatively new addition to the Breakfast Club, Don Cusick.
Stand Where are up, you, Don. Don?
He's a professor at Belmont. And he helped me put this book together, too, and as well as Buddy Cab also helping putting the book together.
He also wrote one of the songs in your new album.
He wrote a song. I got to quote this song.
Okay.
He wrote a song called There Must Be a Pill for That. Don Cusick did. And it starts out.
You want to tell him the inspiration?
Well, I think the inspiration might become evident.
If, okay.
Let me give you the first lyric. I was sitting in a bathtub in the middle of the woods when I looked over to see a beautiful woman in another bathtub sitting right next to me. As our hands reached out and our fingers met, I said to myself, hey, self, I bet here's something you don't want to miss, and there must be a pill for this. What a love song. What a ballad. Boy, I'm telling you.
Raymond, it's good to see you, my friend.
Thank you. It's good to see you. Good to be here.
I want you to stay with us out here and just move over. You guys just move over.
All right.
And stay with me on the stage. Where are we going now?
By the way, I want to say one thing, Ralph.
Okay.
While you're figuring out where you're going. I just want to give you one word.
What?
That popped into my head last night. You are Music City's media anchorman. Anchorman.
Well,
so I tossed that out.
Is
and you
there
can,
a joke coming with
no,
that?
No, there's not a joke. I just think it's very descriptive of who we're talking to here. This guy has anchored more media music shows than anybody alive in Nashville.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Where are we going now? Oh, we're going to launch some careers here. Nashville Now has been very instrumental in not only helping but launching some careers. And we're going to run what at the time was a group of new artists, 1983 to 1993.
Ladies and gentlemen, here is Randy Ray.
Well, the judge, he found me guilty of wrongdoing, and he sentenced me to hang in mid-July. He looked down at me and said, your life's a ruin. If I were you, I'd break right down and cry. Nobody seems to care that I ain't guilty. Lord, I never did the things they said I've done. But I guess they're gonna have to hang somebody. And it's looking like I'm gonna be the one.
Give a little love, and squeeze a little kiss. Give a little hug, I want some more of this. Take a little time, yeah. She's gonna marry
What's your question?
My question is, I'd really never heard of him before tonight, but I think you're absolutely excellent. You did a great job.
Thank you.
And do you have a record out or a cassette out? And if so, the name and where it could be purchased at?
Well, we've got a single out. The album won't be released until April. It's titled Killing Time. But the first single's out. It's been released only to radio. There won't be a record in the stores for some time. And there's a video out also on A Better Man.
Well, that's strange. Why would they release a record to radio and not to the shops?
Well, I don't know. That's why I'm singing and they're releasing records. I have no idea, really.
Gonna be enough to last if tomorrow never comes. So tell that someone that you love just what you're thinking of if tomorrow never comes.
Tonight, I would like to introduce a newcomer to our show, a man who owes his first big break to his wife, from Noonan, Georgia, and also from the Nashville Network. I think he works in purchasing, and I'm hoping he will purchase us some new dressing rooms while he's here. Would you welcome Alan Jackson?
I woke up with her in my arms this morning. God knows I love her over all. She whispers she loves me. Your memory appears. Angel.
Work here for the Nashville Network.
That's right.
In purchasing.
That's right.
What do you purchase?
I don't do a whole lot of purchasing. I do. I'm the mailman too, believe it or not.
Are you?
I do all your mail for
we
you.
We get all the mail through you.
That's right.
If I don't get a letter, write to Alan Jackson.
You get enough. Believe me.
I've been wanting somebody to blame for all 3 years. If I didn't get your letter, you know, sometimes you call me on the phone and say, did you get my letter? He got it.
If I had a nickel for every letter you got, I'd be rich.
Would you really?
That's right.
Well, you're awfully nice.
I have had a hard time getting recognition in this town. Matter of fact, it took me almost 17 years to really get the major label support that I'm getting now. And Ralph Emery was the very first man in this town who really believed in me ever since I was young. That's why you were so mean to me, I guess, when I was on your other show.
Well, I got on to you about some of the slow songs.
I'm looking for something great, like the one that I wore when I first turned to see. Team numbers. in red.
Ladies and gentlemen, she's here. Please welcome Lori Morgan.
Love you. Thank you, babe.
Ooh, handsome men out here.
We've got some pretty girls on the show today, too. How you doing? I don't see you much anymore. I understand you have adopted a new partner out on the road.
I have adopted a new partner. We have adopted each other. Are you talking about Pam?
I'm Pam Tillis.
Pam Tillis. I have a funny story to tell you. Can I whip it?
Sure.
Microphone. Oh.
Yeah, take.
You would think that I would know this by now. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, shall I ask? Shall I ask?
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. I have adopted Pam Tillis, and she has adopted me. We've been out on the road together. We each still continue to do our own shows, but we do our acoustic shows together called Grits and Glamour. And it's really a fun show, but I have to tell you something hilarious that's true that really did happen a couple weeks ago.
Okay.
Pam and I are still some of the only ones that the country brats, I guess you would call us, that still go out there and sign the autographs every night after the show because that's how we were raised to do that. So this one particular night was one of our last shows, I don't know, on some little run we were on. And Pam's like, we got a long line of autographs to go through tonight. So we prepared ourselves for it. And this line went all the way out to wherever it was. And we were sitting there. And this particular night, people were coming by to buy the merchandise. And then they stopped at Pam. And then they stopped at me. And we saw the line kind of parting. And like the Red Sea, kind of. And all of a sudden, out of front of the line steps this little bitty, tiny, old lady. And she looked down at Pam and she said, honey, I'm just so proud I got to see you tonight. You just sounded like a little angel up there singing. Your daddy'd be so proud of you. Looked like a little bird up there singing. And Pam said, well, thank you, ma'am. And she came over to me, and she touched my hand ever so gently and looked in my eyes and said, Lord God, honey, I thought you was dead. It's because we're not on Nashville Now anymore. I cried. Pam laughed.
What was the story you used to tell about the guy that came by with the hot dog or what was it? Came by, you were singing, and he'd been to the concession stand.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about?
I don't remember it. He went to the concession stand and had a hot dog.
And I think he told you ought to get you some.
Oh, yeah, but I don't remember how it went, Ralph. I don't remember how that one went.
Okay. Do you remember being at the Chevrolet Geo Theater when they used to have it at Opryland, and you were performing something in red?
I do remember that,
and,
Ralph.
And it didn't go quite like you planned.
It did not. It did not.
What happened?
It was right on the height of something in red, and my brand new label was in the front row. It was B&A and Rick Pepin and the whole staff. There was like 20 some of them sitting in the front row, and I'd been out on tour on the bus, gone. You know what I'm talking about, where you're gone for days and days and weeks, and I didn't have any clean clothes, and I didn't have any clean underwear.
Well, too much information.
No, it's true. No, listen. So they were all in the bags. You know, you stuff your clothes in bags, and then you get home and you do all your laundry. And I've got this big show at Opryland, and I had this dress that I was going to wear and no underwear. And so
I think you're embarrassed.
Ray, are you going to write a song?
I already have.
Okay.
So, it's called The Street.
You're exactly right. And so anyway, long story short, I put on this dress and I found this little pair of red thongs that I found in my drawer in my bus.
That's underwear, Red.
I wear thongs all the time.
You write thongs all the time. And so, I mean, and so, I was singing this song and, you know, back then we didn't have ear monitors. We just had the monitors on the stage. And I was singing the song. And before I walked out, I asked my friend Ruthie, I said, Ruth, can you see through this dress? I mean, everything good? She said, no, it's perfect. You can't see nothing. The lights are, you know. So I was standing up on the stage, and there are the monitors back here for the guitar player. And I'm backing up, and I'm backing up. And I hit that monitor like this and turned around and fell over, and the dress went up over my head. And there's my label sitting in the front row, and I'm like, well, I was looking for something in red. Now you know I found it. And I'll never forget it. And I keep thinking, you know, my dad used to say, be careful what you do because pictures always come back. But there's never been a picture from that show up, thank God.
Well, I think it's a wonderful story.
Yes.
And it turned into a major, major record for
yes,
you.
Yes, it did. Thank you, Lord.
Lori, how long have we been together?
A long time. I was coming on your show when I was still in grade school.
Now, I'm not talking about Nashville Now, but mm-mm. For years I did a morning television show at Channel 4.
Right.
And you were one of the regulars.
I was. Myself and Kelly Lang and Darlene Austin and Tom and Chris Woolley and Kenny Starr. We all were on that show, and we all were so scared of Ralph. Y'all have no idea. You have no idea. We were petrified of you. We love you. Oh, my gosh, we worship you. But we were scared. It was like...
What were you scared of?
You. Look, let me give you an example.
All right.
All right. I wanted to sing this song for 2 years on Ralph's morning show called Standing Tall. It's a beautiful song. It ended up making a record for me on it. It was a Billy Joe Spears song. And Ralph told me one day, he said, Lori, nobody wants to hear any slow songs at 5:30 in the morning. And so I'm not a big up-tempo song person, you know that. And so every day I'd go in and say, can I sing Standing Tall, Ralph? And he'd say, I said no. No. So I had it all charted, and I gave it to the band. I would sneak it to the band. And so they had it for about a year, I guess. And one day, Ralph didn't show up for work. And I said, we're going to do Standing Tall today. And we're in there, and we're in the middle of singing this song, and we're live on the air, and we're in the middle of singing Standing Tall, and in through the back door of the studio, Ralph was only late. And he walked, and he eyed me, and I'm live on TV, and I started shaking. And he eyed me, and you know this is true. And then he sat down at his desk, and I'm scared to death, and I took my bow when I was done, and I'm shaking, and Ralph thought we were going to commercial, and we were still live. And the camera went to Ralph, and I was done with my song, and Ralph said, Lori, I told you I didn't want any of them draggy-ass songs on my show. And every time I sing it on stage now, Ralph, I think about you.
You know what's interesting? I got one piece of mail about it, and the guy agreed with me.
Whatever. You didn't see the ones I got.
Oh. You, we haven't mentioned your daddy, George. He was a wonderful human being, and he's how I met you. And I think you first came on the show as a very little girl when your daddy was out to do the Christmas show.
Yes.
What'd you sing?
I sang, I'm getting nothing for Christmas. Mommy and Daddy are mad. That's what I sang.
And how old were you?
Oh, probably 7, something like that.
Then later, you became a regular on that show, what, about 13 or 14?
Yes, mm-hmm. I was on a couple days a week.
Yeah,
before school.
Everybody had a day, like you might have had Monday and
right.
so forth.
Right.
Well, I had a lot of fun with you, though.
Oh, I know. Do you remember the day that I had the boom box in there and I was trying to listen to a song to learn between commercial breaks and it went off? It came on real loud and while you were on the air and he chased me out of the studio. He chased me out of the studio, and you asked why I was afraid of you.
Oh, I don't remember that. I did?
Yes, you did.
Haven't you put me in your act on the road?
Uh-huh. I tell that story about standing tall.
I came in there. We had a record player. Remember those records? in the back, near the band, where you could play your record for the band. They get key and tempo.
Right.
And one morning you stumbled right in the middle of whatever I was doing, and you could hear it in Lebanon or Franklin.
That's the day you chased me out of the studio.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, everything came on real loud, and I got in trouble. Just like school.
Oh, I wanted to ask you about another question about your daddy. Your daddy and Hank Williams were friends, weren't they?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What did Hank do to your dad?
Hank, they were two totally different people. Hank was who Hank is, and my dad was, the suit and tie kind of guy. And Hank was in Texas and got arrested, got a DUI, and they threw him in jail. And when they asked him what his name was, he said, George Morgan. I don't know if my dad ever got him back on that or not.
Your daddy loved a practical joke, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
And that carried over to you.
Yes, it has.
Did you ever do anything to your band?
Oh, I've done a lot to my band. I do stuff to my children.
Didn't you have your band put in jail?
I had one of them put in jail. One guy put in jail, handcuffed in the back of a car. Because he was one of those guys that was kind of a player on the road, and he liked the girls out on the road, and we made him think that he was with this girl that was too young. And the police came as a joke and arrested him, and he was crying and profusely, and he was just like, I can't believe this is happening. Which girl was that now? I mean, he was like. So finally, we had to leave on the bus, so they had to let him go. He said, I promise you, I will never pull anything on you again, Lori, ever. I'm done. I said, okay.
Did you get a reputation for being someone that might play a joke on you if you worked for me?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah.
Did you have a hard time finding musicians who would go out with you?
No. No, I didn't. I never had a hard time finding them that would go out. Now, finding the ones that would stay out there and work was a lot harder than finding the ones that would just go out.
I want to compliment you on your video. I play it every Christmas, and that's my favorite things. You did that with the London Symphony Orchestra?
I did, yes.
And I guess in a hotel or a... Where did you shoot that?
I did the video in Central Park in New York.
But it's precious. It really is beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you. And I have to say something.
Okay.
I know this is the launching the career part of the show, and I promise you, had it not been for Nashville Now, my career would not be what it is. And I know that. And I mean, I'm serious. I had more fans in my fan club when my first record came out than a lot of people do ever because of Nashville Now. And you gave me that opportunity to be on national television, and because of that, I mean, I was able to have a career.
Well, I was proud of you, Lori.
Thank you.
When I can find my place, we're going to move on here. Anyway, let's hear it for Lori Morgan. We're going to go back to the tape. I had a Friday night girlfriend. Do you remember her?
Friday night girlfriend?
Friday night girlfriend. Cousin Minnie Pearl.
Oh, yes, yes, of course.
And Minnie Pearl and the staff created a little game called Let Minnie Steal Your Joke. And people would send her jokes by the thousands. The staff would cut them down to about 20. And then Minnie would come in, get with the staff, and they would further cut it down to about 5. And if we used your joke on the television show, we would send you a prize. We also had an applause meter, and the people in the auditorium would vote on which of the jokes was the best joke. And that person would get a big, cheap prize. Anyway, it was a fun game, and we played it for years. And Minnie, I think, had a stroke in 1991 or 2 and had to leave the show. But I had a lot of fun with her. And here is an excerpt from those wonderful days.
I know you're going to enjoy this little lady because everyone that ever has seen her work enjoys her. She came from Grinder Switch, Tennessee a few years ago and told the solemn old judge at the Grand Ole Opry she wanted to do a little talking, and she's been talking ever since. Would you make her welcome, please?
How would it look on Ralph?
You're kidding. Let me see.
It looks great on you. This one, we're gonna send a t-shirt to her, but her joke wasn't as funny as the way she led up to it, so we're just gonna read how she led up to it. She says, this is from Donna Marshall at Versailles, Missouri. She said, "Dear Minnie, I was gonna mail you my joke like they said on TV, but I couldn't get a stamp big enough for my husband." Now, number 3 is from Mrs. Azine or Azine Rush, Monroe, Louisiana. A traveling salesman saw the sign. The traveling salesman saw the sign, Kosciuszko, Mississippi. That's Kosciuszko, Mississippi. Upon entering the town, not knowing how to pronounce it, he asked the waitress when he stopped to eat, "Tell me real slow where I am." She answered, "Dairy Queen."
Hey, this is pretty good this week.
This one's number 5, and it's from Art Weber, Waterloo, Iowa. Played there, too, on a rainy Sunday afternoon. That afternoon, nobody came. That night, business really fell off. After many sleepless nights, Roy dragged himself to the doctor, who told him, "You need to relax, and instead of counting sheep, recite each part of your body and tell it to go to sleep." Before you get head to toe, you'll be asleep. That night he gave it a try. Head, go to sleep. Arm, go to sleep. Fingers, go to sleep, and so forth. He was down to his ankles when his wife walked in wearing a new negligee.
You want to quit there?
Roy shouted, "Wake up, everybody!" This is Nancy Castle. A wealthy woman commissioned an artist to paint a mural of thoughts on Custer's last stand on a wall in her home. She then left for a month's vacation. When she returned, she found the mural, a cow with a halo around his head, and a group of Indians picking cotton. She looked at the artist and said, what's that supposed to be? And the artist said, that's what Custer was thinking at his last stand. He thought, holy cow, look at all those cotton picking Indians. Dairy Queen. Number five, wake up, everybody.
I think on number five, everybody got ahead of you.
Number three, holy cow, look at all those cotton picking Indians.
Manny, I believe the winner is number three.
That's wonderful.
Those were wonderful nights, and it was every Friday night. And Henry would drive the yellow Cadillac out to the back door. He would wait for her, and then she would do her routine with me, and then she did a Grand Ole Opry stint that night. And Mr. Acuff, she'd say, well, I've got to go be with the king. And she'd get back in the yellow Cadillac, and Henry would drive her across the way to the Opry House. And we did that for years. That was a lot of fun. I mentioned earlier that there were some uncomfortable moments, and we're going to go back to Minnie Pearl in a moment. Someone on our staff decided that it would be a great idea to salute the father of country music, the singing brakeman, Jimmy Rogers. And at that time, I don't know whether they still do this or not, but I think in Tupelo, Mississippi, they have Jimmy Rogers Day. And so we informed the mayor down there that we were going to do that. So the mayor came up, brought a delegation of the town's leading citizens, and they're all sitting in the Nashville Now auditorium. The mistake they made was asking Mr. Acuff to be part of that evening. And they should have asked Hank Snow or Ernest Tubb, because they worship Jimmy Rogers. That was not the case with Mr. Acuff. As you will soon see, as Roy and Minnie, and I think Boxcar Willie are in this clip, as we salute Jimmy Rogers, the father of country music.
I'll go with you.
What I'm interested in tonight is you're telling me what you know about Jimmy Rogers. Roy, where were you in 1933 when he passed away?
I was here on the Grand Ole Opry. I joined the Opry in I came here in 1938, man. Yeah.
So it was about 5 years.
Yeah. I was in Knoxville, but I never did get to meet Jimmy. Never, I heard his songs. He was playing a lot of records by him, but I never did get to meet Jimmy in person. And
Was he an influence on you?
No, I don't think so. I wasn't that impressed, I don't suppose. Back in those days, I was doing mostly fiddle music and stuff like that.
He chose to go in the other direction and do hobo songs and railroad songs and unrequited love songs. He chose to do that.
Does the book tell it that he was a pretty mean type person?
Well, I don't know. It didn't say anything about that. No, you're just impossible.
I've heard that.
Let me ask you about an old-timey word. They used the word rounder in a lot of old songs. He was a rounder. Is that
rounder?
Was
that
me? Raised a lot of cane?
He was a pretty mean type person.
Well, I'm not talking about Jimmy Rogers. I'm just talking about the word rounder was used in a lot of songs.
Oh, yeah.
He was a high stepper, you would say.
He carried a pistol all the time, didn't he?
Well, now, listen, you got your information wrong. I mean, different place than I did. I went to that dignified place up there on the corner of 16th, right across from my museum. Down. They didn't bring in that.
I got most of my information from that town down there he lived in.
Oh, excuse me. Really?
I went down there to appear for the first show that they had for him in memory of him. And I went down to a barber shop, and they said, what are you doing in town, Roy? I said, I'm down here to help celebrate the day for Jimmy Rogers. And they said, we don't care nothing about him down here. too.
Well, now let me ask
you. Boy, you won't do. Get him off of here and get him off.
I'm not going to. He was a loved man.
Roy, you know that couldn't be true, or the day wouldn't have succeeded. You know, they continue to have it. Somebody must have liked it.
This was barbershop talk, and I'm...
Oh, I see. Well, you can't depend on barbershop talk.
Bunch of rounders.
No, he was a loved man. He had a lot of friends.
Yeah. Now, Mr. Roy, you told me to get you off in time to get you next door so you can start the 7:30 Grand Ole Opry. So I'm going to do that.
I got my skates right outside.
And Miss Minnie, I'll look forward to seeing you in my hometown of McEwen tomorrow.
Lord willing, I'll be there for the big show. So, tell them howdy. Little loud as anything you ever seen.
And I want to thank you two for coming over. I know you got to go do the Opry.
Thank you,
and Mr. Roy, I'll see you next Thursday.
I'll be here.
Miss Minnie, I'll see you next Friday. Let's say goodnight to Cousin Roy. Bye-bye. Cousin Minnie.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Oh,
thank you.
I could say Mr. Roy and Cousin Minnie.
That was the longest Nashville Now show we ever did. I'll tell you what was funny, and what the audience couldn't see, but Minnie and I, our eyes met. And it was like, what are we going to do, and how are we going to get off?
I could see.
Remember the leading citizens of Tupelo and the mayor? They're all sitting out there watching this.
He's a mean man.
Anyway, I think that Ernest Tubb and Hank Snow would have been better. We've got some scary moments that we're going to show you. And Jack Hanna, I'm sure you still see him. If you have a variety show, I assure you, Jack Hanna will be at your door with his pets. I believe he's from the Columbus, Ohio Zoo. I told Jack one time, don't bring any snakes. Did he follow that advice or that request? No. One night he brought a rattlesnake. And here's the video. I love the way we have this under control. Jack, why are you standing in your chair?
It's under control. It's under control, Ralph. We're under control. Ralph knows that I have everything under control.
Right. Why are you standing in that chair, Jack?
Well, may or may not work, Ralph, but I just want to show you how quick they strike. Here, Shotgun Red, let me have your hand.
No.
I'll tell you what, since we won't do the balloon, let's try the milking, because I want to show people where the venom...
You gonna get a stool and milk that thing?
No.
I'll see you later. Just hold on a second.
Yeah, I think the camera can watch it real close.
Ralph.
He can get up here. You got him? Can we hold the back of it?
I'll see you later. Come out of here in just a second, Ralph.
You can see the look at there. There it is right there. That's what...
Kills you. That's what kills you.
What kind of noise is this?
That's a happy noise.
A happy noise.
He does that only when he's pretty proud of himself. And
oh, here, so hand him an apple. That should work.
Oh, good. Have you seen the teeth on this guy?
Yeah. That's why I'm not handed to him.
Oh, great.
he might even want here. You can try a banana too.
Oh, he's.
He'll give it to you.
Okay.
This is a sea cucumber.
You know what?
You've seen these in the ocean. Now, what they do is, for a means of defense, is they puke their guts out. And that's...
I don't want to hold that one, Jack.
Oh, geez.
You got him back in the box?
the largest beetle in the world. Now, look at that. Rhinoceros beetle. His name's Horny. And this thing.
Hey, he's not happy.
Whoa. I almost lost him there.
I got lost. Boy, we had a few words after that show about snakes. I told Jack never to bring snakes to the show again. And I don't think he did. But that was another long show. I want to, you didn't meet my wife earlier. She worked so hard on this show. I want her to stand up. Joy. Now here is a lady we could always count on, and there was never anything uncomfortable or scary about any of her performances.
Hey, you're from the Smoky Mountain Boys.
Oz, I love you too. I forgot to tell you that tonight. My next guest is a man who, well, actually has eaten crackers in my bed and lived to tell about it. Yeah, my husband, Ken Dudney. I haven't seen much of you today. It's nice of you to do the show tonight so that I could have a chance to visit. Actually, Ken was booked on the show way before I was, and... He was.
Well, I told him, being they didn't want me to host the show, that I might be able to find somebody who could, and you didn't have anything else to do today in between washing the laundry and the cooking, and so, you know, we decided to come over and do it.
You know, that reminds me, this is a wonderful chance for me tonight, folks, because this is my big chance to ask you some questions.
Wait a minute, I want to ask you some first. You know, I was sitting backstage watching all this interviewing going on with the hunk, and...
Well, you know how I feel about the hunk, Rick.
How do you like my hair? I thought my hair was kind of nice.
It looks nice, honey.
Kind of gray. It's getting there.
You know I love gray hair.
And I got some.
That's why I love the hunk.
And I there's a lot. I got a hunk over here.
Who have we got with us tonight? I have a Barbara Mandrell look-alike. Where's Connie Jacobs? Is it Bangor, Pennsylvania? Where are you, Connie?
I'm over here.
Come over here.
Barbie. What do you think, Ralph? Do I look like her?
What are you doing here? You set me up. Did you fill out this card?
Yes, sir.
I'm wired. Your own microphone.
I just couldn't miss this opportunity because I feel like one of the crew and one of the cast at Nashville Now, which is my very favorite show, as you know. And you're one of my very favorite people in this whole world, as you know. And your birthday is tomorrow. And I couldn't have missed wishing you a happy birthday. I was sitting in the Bahamas doing, I'm gonna plug something, I guess, I didn't mean to, but with your hairstylist, Gwen Ankenbauer, watching your marvelous anniversary show.
Mm-hmm.
And
you're feeling guilty
there,
that you took my hairstylist.
Well, not really, you look pretty handsome without her. I don't know, but you did. And no, Gwen and I were saying, oh, Ralph's birthday's coming and I wish I could be there. And she said, oh, he would love for you to be. But my daughter Jamie's having a, even though it's a very late birthday, her party is tomorrow night, so I have to be home having a slumber party for 30 girls. Am I a brave mommy?
Oh, wow.
But I wanted to be here with you say happy birthday.
I had
birthday.
No idea you were here.
Well, your marvelous crew all pulled this off for me, and I'm so happy. And later on, if you take this home, it's a present for you from me, okay?
Well, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
And. I also thought that they were very clever, too. I know my question that preceded that I am a Barbara Mandrell look-alike.
Yeah, you do.
You think I look like that old witch, really?
Now let's meet her in person. Ladies and gentlemen, Barbara Mandrell.
I love you.
Do you remember that?
No.
You don't remember it?
Thank you. I remember the birthday night.
Well,
you know,
when you pretended...
to be Barbara.
Well, you gave me you wrote on the card, somebody did, somebody else's name, and it said, people tell me I look like Barbara Mandrell. So I bought that and went looking around for you, and it was you.
You and I go so far back. Ken, my husband, and I were talking on the way here today. And thank you very much to the Nashville Library for doing this, because my mother said it best. No one deserves more honor, more credit, and more praise than Ralph Emery. And I'm so grateful that this is happening.
Thank you.
You really deserve this. Anyway, now I forgot what I was going to say.
I want to lead you in. I want to lead you into a story featuring your mother, Mary Mandrell.
Yeah.
You went to Vietnam early on, didn't you?
Twice. When I was in high school, I played in my father's band called the Mandrell Family Band, and my mother played bass in the band. And I'll try to tell this as quickly as possible. One summer vacation from school, we went, and then we went the following year. So we spent about 9 months all together there. And this was in 66 and 67. And my mother, I was 17 when this happened. My mother was 34, so she didn't look so bad. I am very blessed to have a wonderful mother that's very precious to me, and she's very quiet usually. But we were, my goodness, you know the old thing where you, a little water and take a sponge bath, or just with a washcloth and a bucket of water or a helmet, whatever we could get. But this time there was a Quonset hut at this camp. I don't remember the name of the area in Vietnam, but I think it was in the Mekong Delta, but I don't remember for sure. My point is there was a Quonset hut that on one side was some barracks and some showers and toilets. And then there was like a little wall between, I don't know how many feet up, so that there was two halves to this. And we were told that this man would stand guard for us if we wanted to shower. Well, that was a thrill. So Mother and I went in there and were showering. And there was this wall where the shower heads. And all of a sudden, I hear something, and Mother hears something. I said, but who's kind of giggling? Did you make a... No. So we start again, and we hear this laugh. And there's a man peeking over the wall of us showering, which, hence the laughter, I guess. But my mother, I said, that man was looking at it. She said, well, we came over here to entertain the boys.
And so you were. She's a wonderful woman.
She is.
Seems to me, in my distant memory, when I first met you, it was your mother, father, and some young man was playing bass, and later he disappeared. And you hired a drummer that you can't get rid of.
Are you talking about, the Mandrell family band?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, my dad hired a young college student that needed like a second or third job to pay for that, and he was a drummer. And I met him in my dad's music store. We were there taking pictures, publicity pictures, and that's when we first met. And we just had our wedding anniversary the other day. That's what I was gonna tell you. We're driving here, and Ken said, I wonder how long we've known Ralph. And I said, Ken, I got here the summer of 68. I've known you since Merle Travis called you and asked you to let me on your TV show since 1968, so 47 years.
Wow. Has it been that long?
And what you all were saying, too, is so true for me. And when we think about it, I'll bet there's not a name, quote name, you know, celebrity person, out of Nashville or the world of country music that can't pull you up at least one story of where Ralph Emery helped them.
That's right.
I mean, the first show I ever did here was his TV show. And he knows how grateful, because I tell you over and over again, he is the great Ralph Emery, but to me, he is Ralphie Baby.
Well, it seems like in your career, Ken went off to the Navy, and you quit. You quit singing.
I retired after the second trip to Vietnam, and was a Navy wife.
Okay.
And when he got sent overseas, that's when I came back to Tennessee for the first time in my life. And that's when it was one of those things, was watching you on television, but I thought, man.
Your daddy took you to the Opry.
He took me to the Opry. Mm-hmm. My dad took me to the Opry, sitting in the middle of the balcony, looking down at that stage and watching everybody. And I thought, man. I looked at Dad and said, if you'll manage me, I want to get back up on that stage. I want to do that. And he said that he would bet his last penny on me. So he dang near did.
So he became your manager for quite a while.
Mm-hmm.
Nice man, your daddy.
Thank you.
Nice. You got a great family. By the way, what's happened to Earlene and
I saw her singing with
Louise.
You on the Hee Haw clip. Louise is not free to talk about it right now, but she's working on a project that's pretty wonderful right now. Neither one of them are retired. I've been retired for 17 years now.
What is your attitude towards singing?
It works for me when I sit on the pew at church. I don't miss
You don't sing anywhere except in church, right?
No, I haven't picked. I sold almost all my instruments when I retired, except from the dobro that was engraved for my parents. And I think that's, maybe I have my guitar. But I sold all my, and the steel guitar that's in the Hall of Fame, I have that. But I just didn't want the temptation, and I've never picked a note or sung.
Who was the Princess of Steel, and who named you?
Sweetheart.
It was Sweetheart of Steel?
When I was 11, that's what they called me, the Sweetheart.
Who named you that?
I have no idea.
Joe Mafis, wasn't it?
Was it Uncle Joe?
Yeah.
I wouldn't doubt it. He and his wife, Rosalie Mafis, gave me my first job at age 11 with them in Las Vegas.
Rose Lee works at the Country Music Hall of Fame today.
Yes.
One more story. How about the time you stayed all night with Patsy Cline on the road?
Ralph likes interesting. Okay, I was, my birthday's Christmas Day, and I had turned 13, and I was doing my first tour, and it was the Johnny Cash package show tour. And he had incredible people on that tour. George Jones, and Patsy Cline was on this. And Luther, I adored Luther. Remember that played the guitar, doom-chicka-doom-chicka-doom, you know, with Johnny Cash, and just, he never smiled. He was wonderful. Anyway, he kind of took me under his wing, because here I was 13 and out on the road with them. And, but Patsy Cline, when she found out that I had my own room, in the hotel rooms where we went. She didn't like that. She said, no, she needs, you stay with me. So, two great memories I have from that. I'm one of the few people you'll ever meet that can truthfully say they slept with Patsy Cline. But I was like one of the kids that, was really rowdy. And I was horizontal to her vertical. And she was saying, Barbara. Yeah. But she said, could you just kind of move over? I mean, I was on top of her. That's my memory. My other memory is she had her hair done and didn't like it at all. And I know I was only 13, but I was pretty good with hair, just like you've always been. You got to when you have to depend on yourself.
That's right.
I don't know what happened today, but usually. I told her, I'm just 13, but I said,
That's pretty gutsy now that I think of it. I said, would you like me to comb it for you? And she, being so gracious and sweet to me, said, sure. And I combed it, and she loved it. And so she, I combed it for every show the rest of the tour.
Rest of the tour?
Yeah. So I have just those sweet memories of her.
Tell me about a guy named Nathan Dudney and his debut on Nashville Now.
Thank you guys for doing that so much. I thank Steve, I thank Shotgun, I thank you for making that happen, because all of the mommies that are watching this can appreciate my youngest of my three children, Matthew, Jamie, and Nathan. Nathan was with me when I was on Nashville Now, and he loved Shotgun Red, as do all of us. And this was a precious moment that Ralph let happen.
Okay.
Is that all you want me to tell?
Nathan is meeting Shotgun Red for the first time, and he totally ignores you and totally ignored me. He couldn't take his eyes off of Shotgun Red.
Nathan has been looking for you all evening.
Did he just wake up, Ralph? How old are you, Nathan?
How old are you?
Three.
Oh, he's only three, Ralph. That's one less than four and one more than two, Ralph.
You're planning to shut down.
But, Nathan, what did you give Shotgun this money for?
For his kid, so he can buy
snow skis.
I'll buy a pair of skis with that nickel, Ralph.
You want to ski with Shotgun Red sometime?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, we could buy a pair of skis and go downhill. We just go fast. Yeah, we can. Hey, Nathan, then when we get to the bottom, we'll fool them all. We'll go back up. Yeah.
Isn't that fun? That was fun. Now, I asked Ken Dudney if he could provide us with a picture of Nathan today. How old is Nathan now?
29.
So show me the picture. There
and that's
he is.
Porter, our brand new grand dog, Porter.
What's the dog's name?
Porter.
Porter?
Uh-huh. He and Nathan and his lovely wife, Dr. Hannah Dudney, she's an OBGYN at Vanderbilt. And that's their puppy dog that they were on a waiting list for over a year to get from Mississippi. So it's a yellow lab, and his daddy's from England, and he's pretty fancy, I guess.
He will get a little larger, won't he?
He will get it, yes, yes. But thank you so much for giving me that moment to share with everybody.
Well, thank you for coming to the show. I appreciate it.
I love you. I love you.
I love you. Shotgun Red has had quite an effect on a lot of his fans, and we want you to take a look at some of Red's best moments.
Got a little cold.
I got something that you can take for that.
What is that?
Well, it's shot of orange juice.
Shot of orange juice.
A shot of grapefruit juice.
Shot of grapefruit juice.
A shot of milk.
Shot of milk.
And 26 shots of prune juice.
26 shots of prune juice.
Yep, just stir that all together and drink it, Ralph.
Will that cure my cold?
No, but you won't dare cough.
I want to know how old you were.
Oh, I'm 1 year younger than Ralph.
Well, now is that in our years or is that dog years?
What's his question, Ralph?
Is your shotgun really red?
But I want you to tell me what your father sent me.
Okay, you asked for it, Ralph. My pop said the next time I saw you, to give you this.
Give me what? This?
Yeah. That's the bird, Ralph. He said to give you the bird.
Ha, 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 ha,
see one country music performer in his underwear, who would it be?
I think it'd be Shotgun Red.
Ralph, how come I'm always the dummy on this show? How come you're never the dummy?
It's been that way for 9 years.
Yeah, but tonight's gonna be different.
How's that?
Because finally the Shotgun Red Company has come out with the Ralph Emery dummy. There it is. Hold him up. There he is. Show him to the camera there, Ralph. Hey, which one's the dummy tonight? Nobody told me you were going on vacation, Ralph. I'm supposed to be here on the show Monday and Tuesday. You're not going to be here Monday?
No.
You're not going to be here Monday? You're going to Hawaii, Ralph? I can't co-host with anybody else. I can't work with nobody but my buddy, Ralph. This is Ralph and Red. I'll boycott.
Red.
I'll take
Red.
It. I'm not going to co-host with anybody else, Ralph.
Red, you'll be on with Johnny Cash.
Have a good trip, Ralph. Yeah, we got a good friendship.
Hey, Red,
hold on a second. Stop the music. Stop the music over there. Everybody, stop the music. Hold on a second. I got to say something.
I've been under your desk for 10 years, and you...
I never thought I'd see this.
I just want to say one thing. You have got to change these socks. You have got to change these socks.
This is Steve Hall. Steve. That's a Nashville Now first. We always agreed that Steve would stay under the desk, but that's the remarkable Steve Hall, who can lie on his back, hold his arm in the air, and be funny at the same time. That's pretty good. And Steve is here. Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Hall. And Shotgun Red. Good.
I want to say one thing. It's been a long time since we was on the show together, and I'm feeling kind of sad. I just wanted to get that in there, Ralph.
Well, I don't know who to talk to.
Well, I can tell you this. Everybody up in Minnesota, there is stars in this audience. I mean, everybody in the world. T.G. Shepherd's here. Kelly's here, his wife. Everybody's here. I'm sitting on the couch along with all these big stars, and I got to co-host with you 2 days a week, every other week on Nashville Now, on national television, and everybody up there said I'd never get a chance to do nothing. By the way, Ralph, does this puppet make me look fat?
How you doing, Ralph? Good to see you. Lori Morgan, and we got Barbara Mandrell. My heart's going bumpity, 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 Ralph. There's Ray Stevens, no bumpity there. Con Hunley, blue-eyed darling, how you doing, Ralph?
I'm doing well, Red. I haven't seen you in quite a while. Where have you been?
Man, I've been on the road doing a lot of shows, worked on General Jackson for about 15 years. Now we're out on tour, and you can check all that stuff out at shotgunred.com. It was never like me to promote anything, Ralph.
Oh, I know that. How many of those Shotgun Red dolls did you sell?
A little over 800,000.
Wow.
Thanks to a guy that held him up on national television every week. And we crashed your morning show. You know, I was on the road playing bars and all the beer nightclubs up and down the road for a long time. And we won a Battle of the Bands contest. We went to Nashville, and a promotion lady said, I need to take you down to Ralph Emery's morning show. Well, I had only heard you on the radio. I had no idea you were on television. So I showed up in a T-shirt, my hair was all messed up, and we walked into WSMV Channel 4. I said, this is a television show. So I ran out the car and got a shirt and ran in the bathroom, straightened my hair, and we crashed your morning show. There was about 25 little Cub Scouts sitting there, and when Red started looking around, lady says, get him out of the case. I said, when are we supposed to go on? She said, we're not. We're crashing the show. I said, we don't have an invitation to be here. They said, no. She said, you're going to make it in the music business. You got to walk on thin ice. And so we're sitting there, and Ralph keeps looking over and seeing little Shotgun Red. I wanted to tell you this part of it. And I'm scared to death, like right now. But and here comes Ralph walking on. I'd only heard him on radio and seen him on some TV specials. And he walks right up to Red, not me, but Shotgun Red. And he's chomping on a cigar, and he says, how does that work? I thought, it's now or never. So I didn't say anything. But Red looked right at him and said,
"You know, I went to that same garage sale. I didn't think anybody'd buy that suit."
And Ralph's cigar come popping out of his mouth and said, "Killer, come over here and get this guy's name. We got a thing coming up called the Nashville Network, and I think I can use him."
It
is great.
What I like about working with Steve and Red is that you don't have to ask any questions. He does both ends of the interview.
Wow.
You
get me pumped up because you are the number one country music television host of all time, and there's nobody in this city like Barbara and everybody said that doesn't owe you everything.
Well, I've got to tell you that when we were new, we were trying to figure out how to get people to watch TNN. We figured that if we could get some kids to watch it, maybe they would dominate the television set in the house and not let anybody turn it to another channel. Now, I went to Elmer Alley, and I've got to give him credit. Elmer Alley created Nashville Now, and he used to be program director at Channel 4 here in Nashville, became program director at TNN, and gave me the job. Anyway, I went to Elmer and I said, "Elmer, I've met this guy that has a puppet. He's a little cowboy, and I think he's pretty good. I think he could help us get some viewers." And Elmer said, "Well, if you think that much of him, let's shoot some video and see what he looks like. I've never seen him." So we were still in the stage door lounge in those days.
Yeah.
So Steve came in and got under a cocktail table and brought Red out, and we did about 10 or 15 minutes. You used to do the guy on Monday Night Football.
Yeah, Howard Cosell, yeah.
Do Howard Cosell.
You want to do it, Red? Yeah, wait a minute, I was supposed to say that.
Unbelievable tonight, from Las Vegas, Nevada, it's the Ralph Emery Show. This is Howard Cosell, speaking of sports.
And Steve, you also had a career at Hee Haw?
Yes. Joe Hostetler, the producer of Nashville Now at that time, took me over there. And, yeah.
Is Joe here tonight?
There he is.
Hi, Joe.
You know, there's so many other people here, too, but I know you're going to introduce them, so I won't interrupt that.
Joe and Elmer Alley, whom I mentioned, and I met at a restaurant on Murfreesboro Road, and Elmer said, "We've got 90 minutes. What do you want to do?" And so Joe and I contributed some ideas. Elmer contributed some ideas, and we created Nashville Now. And of course, over the years, Nashville Now underwent many changes. I had a morning show out at Channel 4, and we weren't sure we could book anybody. So we brought the singing corps from the morning show, of which Lori was one, and Kelly, and Darlene, and Tom, and we created, who am I leaving out, Lori?
Chris Woolley.
Chris Woolley, and
Kenny Starr.
Huh?
Kenny Starr.
Who else? Joy, who am I leaving out? Julie Mainers. Anyway, and I think each of you had a certain night. And if you didn't show up, I'm talking to you, Lori.
Of course, I got in trouble again.
If you didn't show up, you had to send a sub, didn't you?
Yeah.
Anyway, what night did you have on Nashville Now? Did you have two nights?
I had Fridays and Mondays, I think. I had two nights, because I remember leaving Nashville Now and doing the opera.
Okay. All right.
You know, Ralph, I don't mean to interrupt, but I spotted someone in the crowd, Joe Hostetler's assistant at that time, Deborah Bronner. She called me in Canada, and I had no idea that the show was going. She says, "Can you come down here Tuesday and Wednesday of next week? And Ralph wants to put you on the air." I said, "Oh, man." So I borrowed money from everybody in the band. She calls back and said, "Elmer Alley hasn't actually seen him yet. So before we put you on the air, they want to see an audition first, so you can you be here Monday instead?" I thought, oh, now I got like one day to get on a plane. I flew down, I got in a motel, and I called up. Deborah answered the phone. I said, "I'm here." She said, "Who's this?" I said, "Steve Hall, Shotgun Red."
She said, what are you doing in Nashville? And I said, well, we were scheduled Tuesday and Wednesday, but you said he had to see him first so you could be here Monday instead, so I'm here. She said, I'm sorry, I meant next Monday. I was crushed. She says, hold on a second, I'll call you right back. And that's when she called me back and said, Ralph said, do not leave because we want to shoot an audition tape. Don't leave Nashville. Come on over. So we shot it with no audience. And they liked it, and they booked me on the show.
Yeah, Elmer liked it, and a career was begun.
Yes, thanks, Ralph. Everything I have is because of you.
Somebody asked me the other day, who wrote your material?
Well, there was Mike Donegan was one of the writers. He was so funny and so clever. But you put a lot of pressure on me, and you always said, what do you got? And I'd come up with two or three jokes, and you'd say, yeah, okay, what else you got? And I'd come up with another joke. Yeah, what else you got? So a lot of it was stuff that people told me on the road, and I would bring them in. And one night, I was a few minutes late, and Ralph said, there's two times you're never late, the Army and my television show. So they flew Shotgun Red to the wrong city. By mistake. We left Brainerd, and they put him on the baggage, flew him to the wrong city, and then they finally flew him to Nashville, and it was 10 minutes before airtime. I grabbed my rent-a-car, threw him in the back. The guy at the gate came out and threw him in the trunk. We screamed 120 miles an hour down Briley Parkway. Yeah, too late for the cops now. But anyway, we screamed in there, screamed up front, jerked the door open, flew in everybody, the staff, and I ran, and I dove behind the desk, which was like putting 10 pounds in a 5-pound sack, you know? And they went, da-da-da, and the music was already playing, and Ralph's out there talking, and he says, my little buddy from Brainerd, Minnesota, Shotgun Red.
How you doing, Ralph?
And we went to a commercial break. He said, man, they said your rent-a-car is smoking out in the parking lot and all this stuff. And I said, man, I just screamed 100 miles an hour to get here. He said, well, he says, you could have just came on during, like, the second break or something like that. And I said, wait a minute. I said, you told me two times I'm never late, the Army and your show, and I'm on time tonight. That was fun. So I made it.
You know, between you and Lori, I'm not really coming off in this show. I am really a nice guy.
Ralph, we know you are.
We know you're nice, Ralph.
Well, I'm going to move on.
All right.
Just be
quiet.
Quiet. Yes. All right. I want to introduce the Nashville Now band. And Gary, one of the dear, dear friends I have who ran the Nashville Now Band, and before we put the Nashville Network on the air, he had recorded I don't know how many dance shows. Jerry Whitehurst, right over here. Jerry, what did you do prior to the Nashville Network or Nashville Now?
I was a Teamster. I drove a truck.
No, I'm talking about shows.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Didn't you put in the can a bunch of shows called, trying to think who the host was?
Where was this, Ralph? I'm sorry.
The dancer guy? Jackie Ward.
Who? Jackie Ward.
Yeah. Oh, dance, right. We called it Dancing USA. Was that what it was called?
Yeah.
Yeah, we did 60 shows prior to going on the air. Mr. Alley, you know, said we had to have something to air up, you know, beside us. So there was some television done prior to us going on the air. So I did, and then I went to Knoxville and I-40 Paradise. They flew me up there to put a band together, and they did 60 shows.
Didn't the network prepare 13 weeks of programming before we went on the air?
Yeah. Yeah, he was doing quite a bit of work to get the stuff done prior to us going on the air.
How did you pick the band?
Yes, I did.
You want to introduce them?
Well, yes, I do. I tell you, these are some of the greatest people that I've ever been on. 10 years, 9 songs a night, 5 nights a week. They never missed, ever. They were something. And they're my friends, and right to my left, would you like me to do this, is Fred Newell.
Stand up, Fred.
Guitar player. Who probably played on as many records as any guitar player in this town. And next to him, I can see Larry Sasser, steel guitar. They were known as Count and No Count on our Halloween shows. They were great. And behind me is Hoot Hester. Hoot, Hoot. Hoot was Hoot and Two Hollers. They sang. They were the Two Hollers were down here. Yes, they were. And where's my boy Billy? I'm sorry, excuse me. Billy Lenneman, bass. And you know, because I'm just thinking about it, in this business, the way you sit on stage, piano sits here, bass sits here, 30 years I looked at him. He was amazing, a great player. And have I got everybody? Have I got them? Everybody's here. We've lost a couple, Norm Ray and Terry Mead.
Our horn section.
Yeah, a horn section, and our drummer, Clay Care, I think he lives in Florida now. And, but.
Jerry, I must say.
John Clausey, excuse me, Ralph.
Excuse me?
John Clausey didn't get to make it.
I had more compliments on the Nashville Now band than anything else. Everybody respected you. Everybody thought you were the terrific band that I thought you were. And I compliment you on what you did.
Thank you, Ralph.
And though they are not here today, you might mention the singers.
Yes, the vocal groups, Jana, and I think she lives in Branson, Missouri, and then Donna and Craig. I think they live in Arkansas, and I think Craig's working for Loretta Lynn now, playing piano, I believe.
Well, Ned.
Oh, and Ned Wimmer. And I don't know where Ned is. I've not seen Ned in quite a few years. But he was another one of vocal groups.
Well, I want these people to see just how good you were, and probably still are. But we picked a clip from one of the nights at the Nashville Network on Nashville Now. Jerry Whitehurst, the Nashville Now Band. Let's go.
At the heart of Nashville Now, since the beginning, there has been one constant, great music. And for 10 years, a great group of musicians has rehearsed and performed well over 10,000 songs and have played for just about every star in our business. On behalf of all those stars and viewers of Nashville Now, I want to thank you and all of these musicians for being a vital part of our success. Mr. Jerry Whitehurst, I salute you. The Nashville Now Band, the Nashville Now Singer. You've done a wonderful job.
Well, we've enjoyed it. It's been great.
It's been a short 10 years, hasn't it?
Sure has.
Now we're going to share some of that talent with all of you as my dear friend Jerry Whitehurst leads the Nashville Now Band and Singer.
Our last guest, well, actually, that's wrong because we have two more guests to talk about. Our last guest this afternoon is not only one of the biggest stars we've had on the show, but also a very close friend of ours. And here are some memorable moments of her time on the show.
Where'd you ever see a New England shoe? And you'll always have a place to come back to. When whoever's in New England's through, you know this heart of mine just can't be bought. I'm gonna find someone who really cares a lot. When I slip off this little rock,
redhead from my hometown that loves to let her hair down. She tears my heart out when she starts to sing. She's from the right side of that river. She's pretty as a picture, but don't you know she's this old cowboy's dream.
Oh, there's a boy from Moki City, and I sure think he's pretty, and I know he's trying to steal my heart. Said he loved me. Guess he thought I knew.
You know, I'm going to skip now for those who are controlling the events that take place on these monitors. And I will tell you that Reba first agreed to be here, and as I mentioned earlier, Paik McIntyre, who had a career in show business at one time, Paik had a stroke last week, and he's in the St. John's Hospital out in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Plus, Reba is getting ready for her two-month stint in Las Vegas. She said she couldn't get away from rehearsals. So we thank Reba for being on our show so many times over the year. And that was a short stint of what she was capable of doing. I have one other fellow I'd like to talk about, and that's Gary Beatty. Gary Beatty was the voice of the Nashville Now show. And ladies and gentlemen, here is Ralph Emery. I could hear that in my dreams. And he's here tonight with his sweet wife, Marty. And we have some footage. I talked to Gary on the phone about this. He said, I don't remember that. But we find our hero here out in the line of people trying to get into Nashville Now.
We're here. Do you know what that is?
That's a... not a cowboy.
That's a cowboy. Well, I think you're right, Hunter. Let's introduce him. Let's say hello to Garth Brooks, ladies.
Welcome aboard. My name's Peter Paul Peterson.
Say what?
I said my name's Peter Paul Peterson, digital data decoder for the tower.
Well, good for ye.
First night on the job, huh? Yeah. Well, if you have any problems, just use this emergency manual right here. It's the control tower manual for top tower tactics. How'd you like to have to say that real fast?
I don't...
Might have to. Emergency procedures are listed on page 17B. That's item number 7, columns 13A through 13E. Anybody calls in for help, just say as fast as you can, Control Tower for Top Tower Tactics, Emergency Enforcement Facility, then give your PTY number.
Thank you, Ralph. Here we are outside the doors of Nashville Now. Tell me, sir, how long have you been waiting to get in?
What year is that, Mama?
Well, let's see. Willie had his gallbladder out the same year that Mama had a green thumb toenail.
Thank you. Thank you very much, man. Thank you. Thank you. So how long have you been waiting to get into Nashville Now?
Nashville what?
Now.
Like this isn't the Friday night videos, man?
Like no, man. Like no.
Like where am I?
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Tell me, ma'am, how long have you been waiting in line to get tickets?
Years, Bubba. Every night.
Tell me, is the wait worth it?
I don't know. I've never seen it.
You've never seen it? Huh?
No, I just kind of like standing in line looking
yes.
for a man.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I need a real man in my life, Bubba.
Real man.
What sign are you?
Well, ma'am, right now I'm a stop sign. Thank you very much. Life as we know it outside the doors of Nashville Now. Ralph, thank you very much. Madam.
Gary, stand up and take a bow. Gary Beatty. Are we going to roll the clothes from Texas?
Yes.
All right. When we finished this show in, what was the name of that?
Fiesta,
Texas. Thank you, Joy. As I told you earlier, we concluded with 5 days down there. And actually, we did five shows in 4 days because they had to take our truck to Dallas for a drag race. Remember that? So I think on Tuesday, we did our final show plus the Tuesday show. And the world was going around like a pea in a whistle. But and it was kind of difficult for me to say goodbye on Tuesday when I knew we had two more days there. But I think we have our goodbye take on video. Could you roll that, please?
My friends, the time is finally here, but it's not a time to say goodbye. It's a time to say thank you. I personally want to thank you, the audience, the people of America, for allowing me and all of our Nashville Now family to come into your homes and be a part of your lives. We are a family, and you mean everything to us because you're the reason we've been able to have this celebration we call Nashville Now for so many years. We deeply want to thank you for that. Thank you, too, to all the wonderful people who have called and written to us, asking us not to leave. Friends, we're not leaving. We're just moving on to new venues. And thanks to all the stars who've dropped in throughout the years, just so that we could share their talents, their gifts of music and laughter with all of you. And I hope we were able to bring a smile to your face when you needed one most. It's been a long road, one filled with great memories and more memories, but especially one filled with friendship, with all the talented people who have made this show happen night after night, the band, the staff, and the crew. These people are the backbone of Nashville Now. We're excited about the future, and all of us are going to continue to bring you great country music and family entertainment. So everyone here and all of you watching, thanks for being here. Now, I want you to applaud all these wonderful people. And let me say this, that not quite all of them are here from Nashville, but these are staff members who have made Nashville Now work. Our producer over on the end in the almost orange shirt, Bill Turner. Our cue card people, every one of them. You've been giving people standing ovations all night. How about giving them one?
That was our close. Now, I've gotten ahead of myself. I want to show you one other thing. When Garth Brooks first came to our show, Gary Beatty's little boy introduced him, and you saw that. And how old was he? About four? Three?
Four, like they could, yeah. And he's the one who said he looks like a cowboy because he had on a cowboy hat. I think we have the picture of what Hunter, look, there's Hunter today. And I want to thank all of you. If you ever worked on Nashville Now, I want you to stand up, would you please? I want to thank all these wonderful people, all old friends. You know, I kind of fudged when we picked the talent. I wanted people on the show who made me comfortable because they were close friends of mine. And all of you qualify. Thank you, Con, Ray, Lori, Barbara, Steve, and Shotgun Red.
And Ralph, if I don't throw Pretty Miss Sheila a kiss, I'll sleep on the couch all week.
Anyway, that's our show, my friends. Thank you for coming.